When I was studying with Dale Clevenger 25 years ago, and he had this concept that he called thick air. And it took me years and years and years of exploring what the heck is thick air. And through my exploration of trying to figure out what is thick air, and teaching the concept and also playing it, I learned a lot of different things about how to hold the lips. And in teaching this, I found learning from my students, wow, that works, and wow, that doesn't work. And now I've come up with my own philosophy of what I call heavy air or weighty air. And is, I believe it's the missing link to thick air. So thick air is where your lips are open as wide as they can. And the missing link is that it's resting on the bottom of the note. Now, the bottom of the note is a place that I call the bark point. The bark point of the note is where it speaks the quickest, is the most clearest sound, and also when you're moving to other notes, that bark point is the easiest point to move from. So in smooth playing, if you connect all the bottoms of all the notes at this bark point, you can have creamy, smooth playing. And the mastery of the horn that Dale Clevenger exemplifies is this thick air, but at the bottom of the notes. And I'm just going to give you a little bit of a sample here of playing smoothly through the notes. Now that was from bottom of the note to bottom of the note without going to the middle and then to the bottom. And I'm going to show you what it is if I go to the middle, bottom, middle, bottom. And Dale used to call that twa-twa playing or chewing. So the technique to hold the air always at the bottom of the note is what I'm going to talk to you about today of how to do that. So if you set up a brass player from day one with these five essential techniques, someday later they will be able to work in the arena of this mastery like someone like Dale Clevenger. So it doesn't guarantee that you're going to be a master of the horn, but you're definitely guaranteed not to be able to master the horn if you don't have these five must-have techniques. So this is about what will carry you in an extreme situation. People can play the horn all over the place, or any brass instrument, and get a varied sound. You know, it doesn't matter really where you put it on the lips, you're going to get a sound. But to attain the extremes, loud and soft, smooth, high, low, all the extremes, with delicacy and mastery, I believe these five must-haves have to be in a player's repertoire. And what are these five must-have techniques? Not in any essential order. The first one I have is the chin muscle must be flexed downward. The next one is the mouthpiece must be placed below the bottom lip pink line. Another is the two-thirds upper, one-third lower lip in the mouthpiece. Another is the angle of the mouthpiece needs to be more down. So you're pressing into the bottom lip a little bit more so the top lip is free to buzz. And the last one is the tongue is down. You must have all of these in order to be in the ballpark of achieving the higher level techniques. So back to thick air. Playing with thick air, how are these five techniques being employed? Well, I said earlier, thick air is opening the lips more open. So what opens the lips more open is, I believe, when you pull the chin muscle down, you're pulling the bottom lip down. And you can tell very quickly with a young player, they'll have a pinched sound. And this is because the lips in the center are being pinched together, and you want to open the lips. So the first thing to get them to master is how to flex the chin downwards so they can pull the center of the lips open. So getting the chin muscle flexed downwards is one of the most important things in any brass player's technique repertoire. The next one is having the mouthpiece placed below the pink line. Now this is somewhat of a controversial topic in that some people's lips are a little bit too big, so they believe that they have to put the mouthpiece in the pink. My philosophy is you just need a bigger mouthpiece, because the anatomy, physiologically, the muscles that attach the chin connect to this bottom lip, right at the pink line. And when you have the mouthpiece placed under the pink line, and you flex your chin, you can pull down, the airstream to connect to the bottom of the note. And you can have a little ridge right here, right under the pink line, that you can tug on. If the mouthpiece is placed over the pink line, you will inherently pinch while you play, because this is a very strong muscle grouping, and it'll want to try to get involved. So you want it underneath the pink line so you can pull open while you play rather than pinch. Two-thirds upper, one-third lower. I have found that the top lip produces a much warmer sound than the bottom lip. If you have too much bottom lip in the mouthpiece, you will have a harder, brighter sound, regardless of what instrument you're playing. And I found that the perfect relationship of upper to lower lip is about two-thirds upper, one-third lower. So this means that when you're looking at the corner, you'll see about two-thirds upper, one-third lower, and you can also pull out a ring of your second slide to look inside when you're buzzing to see if there's two-thirds upper, one-third lower. And there are other devices you can use to confirm that. Still keeping the mouthpiece underneath the pink line, having two-thirds upper, one-third lower. And this goes right in line with angling it down also. If you press too much into your upper lip, you'll have a hard, brighter sound. So angling off is right connected with the two-thirds upper, one-third lower. And of course, the tongue is down. If you have everything else set and all you do is just touch the tongue up and down in your mouth, watch what happens to the sound. It goes nasal when it comes up, and it goes open when you come down. Basically, you want to envision an egg is in your mouth, so your tone is as open as possible all the time. Between slurs, high range, low range, always open. As soon as you raise your tongue, you have maxed out the top of the note. You always want to stay with the tone and air at the bottom of the notes, where the best sound is. Back to incorporating, how do we get the air at the bottom of each note? I have two techniques that I like to employ that challenge or use these five techniques. One is called a jaw vibrato. Basically, if you can lock your chin into one place, all these muscles lock into the bone. They become fixed with the bone. Then if you move the whole jaw, you're in effect moving the bottom lip. So you're going up and down with the airstream inside the note, feeling where is the bottom of the note. Now, one thing I have to say, the groove of the note, the bottom of the note, is created by a firm bottom lip. You want a firm bottom lip. If your bottom lip is relaxed, here's what happens. The note immediately dissolves. The bottom of the note, the groove, sags. And this becomes very, very prevalent and obvious in the low range. The note just goes kaboom, it falls to pieces if your bottom lip is loose. So you must have the bottom lip firm and the top lip free and relaxed. So with that said, with your bottom lip firm, do a jaw vibrato to feel this air cushion at the bottom of the note. Now I often have two magnets that I employ, and if you turn them just right, they will oppose each other, and you want to feel that little cushion between them, because that's what it's like with the air going down to the bottom of the note. The bottom of the note sort of repels the air at one point, and that's a really critical point, because you want the horn actually to participate. You want it to hold up the note to some extent so your lips can relax. I'm going to say that again. You want to find the bottom of the note to the point where the horn starts to participate with you and you can rest your lips and the horn holds the note up to some extent. If you always are clamping your lips and holding everything in the middle of the groove, you'll become more fatigued, the tone is brighter, and you're always in the middle of the note. So you'll be going middle, bottom, and so you won't have a smooth playing. So the goal, keep the air at the bottom of the groove. So you use your jaw vibrato to find where the bottom of the note is. And the second one is what I call forte piano breaths. The forte piano breath is where you blow a lot of air in a short burst, and as you might know, when you add a whole bunch of air, you have to relax the lips to compensate, otherwise the note will take off and shoot over the groove like this. So if you don't relax the lips and you add a bunch of air, you'll go sharp. So while you blow a bunch of air, relax. And this is like a radar sensing where's the floor. So again, these two techniques are finding how do I find the bottom of the note and how do I rest the air on the bottom of the note, the optimal resonance and tone quality of the note. So putting these together, I then use a trill exercise to practice moving from one note to another note. Now this jaw vibrato and the forte piano breath are simply to find one note. Now how do you move from one note to another note? This is what the trill, I think, does beautifully. So finding a G, pushing down 1 and 3 so you can play an A as well, and coming up to an A. Now here's an interesting little technique that I found. When you are slurring up, the chin loves to crunch up. This happens all the time with younger players. If you can keep the chin flexed down with this bottom lip really clamped hard, you can go from bottom of the groove to bottom of the groove. And that's what the goal is. And if you put your hand underneath the chin, you can see the height of the hand go up and down if you're really using the jaw. If the jaw is not moving, then you're just using the lip muscles, and that means you're squeezing and holding. So now, using forte piano breath to confirm inside the trill. Adding that also with the jaw, you have two confirmations that you're always resting on the bottom of the groove. So I love to use the trill as a technique to put all these into play. So we are now moving into having the horn hold the note up, and how do we use the lips to find the notes, the bottom of the note. That is basically job one of the lips, is to find each groove. Now backing up from that, on the mouthpiece, there are no grooves, are there? The horn has these ledges we need to find. And I've often found that sometimes there will be a problem in the horn playing that I need to backtrack into the embouchure itself, how the lips are held. And doing it on the mouthpiece is a fabulous way to expose some of the embouchure inadequacies. And even before that, taking the mouthpiece away and just looking at how the lips are held is very, very important. And I've developed something I call the horsey buzz. And if you go to my website, hornlessons.org, I have a video that's free on the order page. And you can practice this at home. It's basically how to hold a buzz from low to high and back down. There are many ways to do it, but I have come up with two ways. One's a vertical and one's a horizontal. The horizontal way is just to imagine your lips are like zippers from the corners to the center, or Ziploc bags. You hold at the corners, and then you seal them to the center as you go higher. The vertical way is you let everything go, and you sound like a horse. That's why I call it the horsey buzz. You start at the corners, only holding the corners, and everything else is relaxed. That's one. Step two is your chin is flexed. Hear the buzz come up. And step three is squeezing the bottom lip. You hear the pitch even come higher and higher. So this is isolating and controlling each one of the muscle groups so they're like puffed out or uncontrolled. Remember, we want the bottom lip firm because that creates the ledge that we're going to trust and rely on. So you've got to get control of your bottom lip so your top lip can be free. Hold at the corners so you can relax the center. Thick air is about holding the lips as open as possible. But you can't relax the center unless you hold somewhere. So we are practicing how to hold at the corners so we can open and relax the center. And here is a sample of holding the center and then opening the center. I'm not sure the audio you'll be able to tell there, but it's one is nasal, and if you have a starting student that's starting out and you hear this nasal sound, that's because they're pinching right in the center, and you want to get them to somehow hold at the corner so they can open up the center. And I have some worksheets and some handouts that are available on my website. And in fact, if you go to hornlessons.org and you go to free stuff, under the April 13th Skype Masterclass, the Band Director page 1 has horn embouchure technique for band directors. And I have the 5 must-have techniques right on that page. And I also talk a little bit about lip size, and if you're starting out youngsters and they've come to you in 4th or 5th or 6th grade and say, you know, I want to play trumpet or I want to play trombone or something like that, you know, that's fine. You give them the instrument and you help them how to play. But if you have a band program that's already established and you don't have any horn players and you're just trying to decide, okay, how am I going to build my horn program? Am I going to get clarinets to change over? I got 50 flutes. I've got 50 trumpets back there. What am I going to do about getting a horn section? So you're going to be taking some players and transferring them over to being a horn player. Oftentimes, a lot of young band directors start out young players all playing trumpet, which is totally fine with me. But I have one major problem if they all have half upper and half lower, because the one when they come to the horn player, being a horn player, they have a very, very bright sound. It is my experience that if you start all brass, two-thirds upper and one-third lower, they can go to any instrument and have the most rich and warm sound. And I know some really great lead trumpet players that have two-thirds upper, one-third lower, and they still have the screaming high range, and their tone is so much more enjoyable to listen to. So, you've got a band program, and now you're changing players over to horn, or even if you're just starting horn players out, you can use these 5 must-have techniques. And then, for whatever they do, they can go on and do whatever they want. And the college professors, when this guy says, well, I want to be a professional player, they're already set up with their embouchure. It's very, very unfortunate if you give a kid a French horn or a trumpet and you just let them put that on their lips any way they want, and it's like the first day they push that onto their lips and they kind of struggle around to how to find a note, and then they latch on to whatever system that is, and then they are stuck with it. And I've taken many, many people through embouchure changes, and I know how difficult it is to change a person's belief system and muscle memory. It is crucial to make a person's life much easier to start them out with this technique so they have the choice later to do what they want, and it's not such a traumatic experience to go through the changes. So looking at this page of horn embouchure technique for band directors on my website, hornlessons.org, I also talk about the horsey buzz, mouthpiece buzzing, and on the horn about tonguing, starting and stopping. And I'm going to talk a little bit about tonguing right now. I believe right before you start a note, it helps to find bang right at the bottom of the note if you hold the air at the lips. And I have a technique that I have in some of my videos called hold the air at the lips. And this will avoid anybody having a stutter problem later in their career before they play a note because they're holding with their throat. And if you teach this to young players, they don't think anything about it. You inhale, seal your lips on your tongue. You start to pressurize like you're exhaling, but you hold the air at your lips. And then all you do is let the tongue back. You control all the air with your tongue. It never goes and closes in your throat. So sealing the lips on the tongue is a critical technique to have before you start every note, unless you're doing a breath start. And I will talk about breath starts in a moment. So sealing the lips on the tongue before you play every note. It relaxes the throat entirely because all the air is pressurized right at the lip according to whatever volume you need, and everything else just goes, ah, thank you for holding it here so I don't have to hold it anywhere else. So we'll close the lips on the tongue, and that goes bang, right into the bottom of the groove of the note. Breath starts. Of all the things Dale Clevenger taught me, I think the most valuable and practical for applying the most advanced techniques on a brass instrument is the breath start. Now, a breath start is where you just blow a little bit of air and you try to find a subtone before the actual note starts. And I'll do it and see if this can actually be picked up on a video. There's a little tiny sound before the actual note starts. And that means that you are perfectly aligned with where that note is going to be resonating. Sometimes you'll hear a little sound that's higher or a little lower, or there's a pop. That means you're not perfectly aligned with where the note is. So you're going to have to do a lot of adjusting with your slide, refining your embouchure to make sure it's very, very efficient and relaxed in order to master the breath start. And you should be able to do a breath start in everything from a low C to a high C, because the Britten Serenade has a very, very soft note on a high C coming in. So using the breath start refines your embouchure and gives you the air finding the note, not the lips clamping. So it takes you to this final frontier of thick air and heavy air by the air finding the note. And once you get into this final arena, what we're focused on basically is how the air finds all the notes, not the lips clamping onto them. So you're letting go of the lips and the air is resting on the groove. You do a little forte piano breath and you can feel this air cushion feeling down on the bottom of the note. You play with heavy air, your mouth stays open, and the tone is the most relaxed it can be. So without talking about too many advanced techniques, I've talked about some of the basics, which is the five basics, and I'll review them now for those that are coming in late. The chin muscle is flexed downwards. The mouthpiece is placed below the pink line. The two-thirds upper, one-third lower. The angle of the mouthpiece is down. And the tongue is down. Now, there are many other advanced techniques that I believe are must-have for later, but for beginning and young players, these five are essential to attain everything else. And this is Michael Boyle, a junior at UNC Chapel Hill.
One of the most important parts of your embouchure, I think, as well, is the zipper lip action, is what you would talk about in our lessons. And it may have been because I came in late, I didn't hear you elaborate on that. Could you elaborate on kind of how that helps you change on the grooves? Because a lot of people have that misconception of loosening the bottom lip to change notes. Well, if I have to keep the bottom lip firm, how am I supposed to change notes then? And the concept of the jaw movement coupled with that zipper lip sideways action is the principles of achieving that.
Very good. So I have my horn book, which looks like this, and it's available on my website, has some basic warm-up exercises in it. In addition to the trill, I have my basic warm-up, which goes into what Michael's talking about. simply going back and forth between a C and an E. Now the E naturally rests 14 cents flat. Most players try to correct that in their ear and pinch to the middle of the groove. So what we're trying to master is how to hold the air at the bottom of the groove for both those notes. There are two principles working here. Michael expressed both of them. One is the zipper lip to the center, U, that one, and the other one is the vertical jaw moving up and down. We want to coordinate both of them. Yes, the lip needs to firm a little bit to get the frequency of the E. But if it only does the zipper lip, U, we will be in the middle. So we need to be able to hold it down with the chin flexed, pulling the airstream down, and popping the jaw up only to the bottom of the E. Now, if I don't do the chin and all that, and I just use the zipper lip, here's what happens. I pinched. Or, if I only do the crunch, same thing. I go bright and nasal. So holding the chin down and doing both at the same time, zipper lip to the center, U, and the jaw only popping up to the bottom of the E will incorporate a nice smooth and open sound in the slur. Did I cover the point, or do you want to add anything else?
Exactly.
Very good.
I know one thing that you have told me a lot is the concept of keeping the lips forward, pushing them forward, not spreading out on the mouthpiece. Maybe just elaborate on why that's such a good thing with endurance and not bruising the lips.
Thank you very much. Lauren is talking about having the lips forward. And I have often thought about making that one of my five must-have techniques. It is definitely one of the must-have techniques for advanced playing. And I'm going to come out and say, never stretch the lips. And of course, never say never, but I can't find of a good reason ever to stretch your lips. You can hurt yourself with your lips thin. Also, it makes your sound bright versus your lips being forward. Technically, for getting the air on the bottom of the groove, holding your lips forward, you have a lot more control, and it also gives a fantastic sensation that you're blowing a tunnel of air. So, Lauren talked about endurance as well. With your lips forward, you can pretty much, you know, use as much pressure as you need and play a lot longer. If she just finished a concert without an assistant, and both Michael and Lauren were playing principal in that concert without an assistant, and doing, you know, Dvorak 5 and other repertoire. And they had very, you know, long rehearsals day to day and on that day, and then their concert. So holding the lips forward gives you an incredible amount of endurance, as well as opens your tone. Remember, it's all about holding the air more open for thick air. So sound, endurance, getting the sensation that the air is a tunnel and weighted down, all has this shape of ooh with your lips forward. Of course, you don't want to go too far, but you definitely don't want some stretched back. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you, Lauren. Hey, Michael Boyle again.
Another important thing I like that you address about controlling the tone of the horn, it does not involve in any way the mouth, but it involves very much the positioning of the hand and how important that is in the versatility of horn playing, from if you're playing hand horn all the way to stopped horn, and why it's important to always have it consistent, and why it's important to have it the certain way that you teach us so that you are able to do all these things quickly and efficiently. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Great points, Michael. Michael is talking about the hand position and the importance of the hand position for intonation. And I'm going to make the point that for the most advanced level playing, I believe that a player can feel the air pressure coming from his stomach totally free all through his mouth and feel it at his right hand in the bell. So it's a connection between your stomach and your right hand, because the right hand actually determines where the groove is as well, because you can bend it flatter and sharper. So if you really sense that you're blowing all the way through to your hand, you will even free up even more the mouth as being a constriction source to actually put it all right on your hand, and it has a great sense that you're blowing through the horn. But backtracking from that, the importance of the hand is multifold. It actually holds the vibrations of the frequencies together as the vibrations come out the bell. So you're actually holding the molecules together. So you need it in the bell, and I say all the way in until your knuckles stop. And that in that position, you have one position that you constantly put in, it's not floating around, so you always have the same intonation. So this also is determining your sound, because if your hand floats out of the bell, it'll be brighter. So you always want a consistent position. So how far to put it in the bell is, I think, a very interesting topic. And I like to use the example, if you play a B flat, thumb and one, or first valve, and then play it open, it will go about 31 cents flat. So the hand horn technique needs to be able to come out the bell sharp enough to make it 31 cents sharper. So here's how it looks. So with your hand in, you have correct intonation, and then when you pull it out all the way, the open B flat should be in tune. So that means that you're bending the horn down all the time, about one third of a pitch. And this allows you to have a lot of control with the horn intonation-wise with your hand, so you don't have to manipulate the lips so much when trying to tune. Of course, your slides are the main tuning mechanisms, and I have a lot of tuning exercises in my horn book. But the hand is critical to be consistent with the intonation, to have a warm tone, hold the molecules together actually as you go higher and higher. On one of my videos, I show you how they will dissolve your hands out of the bell. You have locked in, but with your hand out, it just glisses. There are no longer any ledges because the molecules aren't being held together. You want to add anything else, Michael?
That was perfect.
Very good. Okay. Danielle has a comment.
I was just going to say, before Edward was asking you how you teach us without overwhelming us, I think that the most helpful thing is when you show us like exactly what we're doing wrong on the horn and demonstrate it to us, and then show us the correct way to do it. Mm. I think that's really helpful.
So Danielle was saying an effective teaching technique that she has found is that if the teacher is able to copy what the student is doing and then be able to do it differently. So, for instance, if the tone is too bright, for the teacher to be able to do it too bright, and then be able to do it darker, and then be able to show technically what the difference is. For instance, I do this a lot with my beginning students when they come and they sound really, really nasal. And, you know, what... how do they get that sound? So I try to figure out what are they doing with their lips to get that, you know, really nasal young sound. And I squeeze the center of my lips as hard as I can. So okay, well, if you sound like that, then what do you have to do differently to sound? And they can see, oh, his mouth is opening up, his jaw is coming down, and the sound is different. So they can see both ways, and as Danielle says, that works very well for her.
I don't know how much you want to talk about slide placement, but I just know for me, one thing that you kind of ingrained into me here at UNC is how flexible you need to be with moving your slides. Because I know personally in high school, I would get my horn out every day and then just play it and not even think about the slides, and I feel like that's the case for a lot of younger players. But just emphasizing how much of a difference it makes when the slides are in the right place and
absolutely
playing with the grooves.
So slide position. The largest factor in determining slide position for me is the temperature in the room. When it gets hot, the horn goes sharp, so you need to pull out the slide. And when it gets cold, you need to push the slides in. Now, this is a totally different outside variable in addition to how you're doing the muscles on your lips. Now, I can put my slides pretty much in any position and play in tune, but I'm having to work really, really hard with my lips and the sound compromised. So we want to find the optimal slide position so I can relax down on and rest on the groove. Now, with ensembles, they're a kind of a beast in themselves in that you can practice 440 and, you know, get your slides all lined up in a perfectly temperature room, you know, 72 degrees. Then all of a sudden, you go into a really hot stage, it's 85 degrees, and your horn has, you know, if you play with, say, a slide position, you're extremely sharp. You've got to move those slides. Or vice versa, if you go into a really cold band room after being in a warm room, you're going to be really, really flat. So you've got to be really good about moving your slides to adjust to the temperature. Now, aside from temperature, the lips, if you hold more, you're going to be sharper. If you open and relax, and you go down to the bottom note, you're going to be flatter. So the way that you hold the lips also determines the intonation. Getting consistent with your embouchure and hand position all are part of the package, and then this eternal variable of temperature. So there are a lot of things going on that you need to master in order to be, you know, not busting notes all over the place. And I've really been frustrated with my orchestral work. We would go to different venues every night, you know, this cold, dark cathedral or this bright, hot, you know, lamp, rotisserie lamp, and the temperatures would be wildly varying, and I had to throw my slides in order to stay in tune. So it's an excellent point. And you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I guess also just you have the exercise in your horn book, but going down like chromatically and back up so that the slides relative to themselves, like the first and second slides, those are in the right spots too. Because I know I've been working with that a lot and try to get just the right settings.
Excellent. Yes. So there's basically two kinds of intonation. One is vertical, where you're going up and down on one overtone series, trying to feel where are all those grooves that line up perfectly for that one overtone series. And then you're going to do multiple overtone series horizontally. And this is in my horn book as well for slurring, is you want the airstream always open and thick and weighted down, and it has to stay open evenly through those slurs, just like going down a stair and coming back up. It can't go all of a sudden drop a lot and then high. It's got to be one, the slides have to be perfectly set so your mouth can always stay open with the air weighted on the bottom of the slur. And this takes a long time to master, but if you stay with it and have strong willpower and technique, you can do it. So what Michael brings up for me is, like you said, you can play with any embouchure and get a result. What we're working on here is what can take us the furthest. So if you ever go take a lesson with Dale Clevenger or want to play with the Chicago Symphony, what kind of level are they playing at? And you're not going to have a chance unless you have these techniques already locked in and mastered, so you can start dealing with some very, very elevated concepts that take you to, you know, some of the level of playing of the greatest horn players in the world. So these are for designed to hold up in very, very stressful situations. So like a high B flat in Beethoven 4, coming in a high B flat night after night, you know, how are you going to play a B flat and not bust it every night? So what technique are you going to have to incorporate so you're consistent, rather than just hoping it'll come out, holding the air up the lips and making that thing ping right out? Over and over, night after night, you have to have a technique, a tool that you use, rather than just smashing it and praying. So this is for extreme playing, holding up in extreme situations, and not meant to invalidate anyone's system of playing. If you're happy with your system and you like it, then great. You don't need to change. I mean, everything is fine. Well, I'm not trying to change anyone that doesn't want to change. But if you're a young player and something's not working, you might want to look at these techniques to see if they can help your playing. And the proof is in the pudding. It will immediately get better or it won't. So if it's going better and it helps you, great, do it. If not, don't. My motto is whatever works. So in closing, I want to thank Dr. Evan Feldman, who is assistant professor of music here, as well as the wind ensemble conductor, for making sure that we had all the technical facilities available, and also Terry Rhodes, our department head, for supporting our activity. And also, I encourage you all to go to my website, hornlessons.org, and purchase my horn book, which has the explorations of these techniques. And also, my CD, A Passion to Horn, is available as well. I hope you'll take a visit to my hornlessons.org and send me a Skype. And if I can help, please let me help you in the future. And we will say thank you very much.
Go Tar Heels!